teachings on the Holy Spirit, the series entitled Drawing Closer to the Flame. Today, we want to talk about Pentecost. Today, we celebrate Pentecost Sunday. Although Pentecost Sunday, in actuality, was May 24th, it was the fourth Sunday in May, we did not get the opportunity to practice it, celebrate Pentecost, and to no one's fault but mine, amen. Pastor counted the days wrong, amen. In a minute you'll see, and so rather than not having a service recognizing Pentecost, we're going to call this Pentecost Sunday, amen. All right, is that all right? Amen. So today is Pentecost Sunday, and we are grateful that we're able to gather today. We do want to remember in our prayers Brother Arthur Pritchard, who was hospitalized last week, and then we want to remember, I got word that Sister Patricia Royal was also hospital last week, and so we want to remember it, but we know God is able, amen. And those that have been in the hospital, we thank God that they're out, and we give God the glory. Our idea that we've been focusing on is called, we entitled it, Drawing Closer to the Flame. Drawing closer to the flame. Turn to somebody and just tell them, you got to draw closer to the flame. Amen. Drawing closer to the flame. We want to continue along that thing because we want to focus on Pentecost. And if you would allow me, Sister Bertha, I want to break Pentecost down into what we teach in schools. When we try to get kids to understand particular lessons, we give them a targeted focus, if you will, a targeted focus. And the focus is when you're studying something, you want to talk about the what, the when, the where, and the why. Y'all remember that in school? And sometimes they throw in the how, but I don't like the how because that starts with an H and everything else starts with a W. So we're going to focus on the what happened and when did it happen, where did it happen, why did it happen, and then I'm going to give you four points of understanding when we talk about this thing, Pentecost. First of all, let's turn our attention to Acts chapter number 2. Acts chapter number 2. All right, Acts chapter number 2, and we're going to start there. We're going to start there. Acts chapter number 2. All right, Acts chapter number 2. And beginning at verse number 1, we're going to read verses 1 through 4 in Acts chapter 2. All right, y'all have that? Okay, as we know, in the book of Acts was penned by the apostle Luke. Many maintain theologically that the book of Acts is a continuation of the gospel of Luke, theologically. But he is the author, and he writes to us today about his viewpoint of what occurred in a wonderful time in the life of the church. Let's read verses 1 through 4. Verses 1 through 4. Let's read those. They celebrate this as the day of Pentecost, amen. And it's a wonderful, description of what happened, Imani, in that first Pentecostal experience. And what I noticed, and what you have to understand, is that when we talk about what happened, all right, what happened is significant because today this particular text is a watershed moment in the life of the church. It is a Pentecost. This is the day that is recognized in the Christian church as being the birth of the church. Now understand, there were many that during this time in ancient history that were moving as disciples of Christ, people in the way, they call them, that they were functioning to share the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the region of Asia Minor, and they were being very effective. But now, this day, the movement of Christianity becomes an organized body. Pentecost is that celebration of the event that is the birth, as we understand it, of organized church, organized Protestant church. It is that day we are to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ during the season of Advent. We are to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus keeping his promise that after 3 days he was going to get up with all power in the palm of his hand. But I am of the opinion that just like we celebrate our birthdays when we were born into the world out of our mother's womb, the people of God who accept Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior ought to do well to celebrate Pentecost, because Pentecost is birthday time. Come on now, amen. And I never knew anyone that had a birthday that were not proud and happy that you had another day. Come on now, amen. You celebrate. Come on now, to be real. All of us celebrate our birthdays. And I believe that the organized body of believers called the church, the ecclesia, the people called out of sin into a world of into a life of righteousness, ought to celebrate on Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost, the colors of Pentecost are red and gold and the images of fire. Because if you think about it, the text says that it gives us the description of what happened. Verses 2 and 3 says what? It says it suddenly. That means something happened, no time frame was given to it. It just happened. And what Luke describes is what he sees in his humanistic viewpoint. He said there was a sound that sounded like the rushing of the wind. That's what Luke says. And then he says there was something that it wasn't wind, but it sounded like wind. That's the best description I can give of the thunderous roar that was heard in that room. And then he says, and it looked like there was fire, that like cloven tongues of fire that sat on every disciple in the room. Luke gives a description that it sounded like thunder, like wind, but then it looked like fire. Understand, Luke couldn't even give it a description, because what he had seen, what he experienced, was the thing that God had sent that could not be limited by our own humanistic grammar or words. There was nothing in our vocabulary that could adequately describe what they were experiencing on this day. But now here, the fire is the good part. Do y'all know what fire? Do y'all like fireworks? Anybody like fireworks? Come on. Anybody like fireworks? Has anybody seen Macy's fireworks? Or matter of fact, remember Kaboom? Here in Red Bank, they had Kaboom, and it was amazing because Kaboom was synchronized in Red Bank with Rumson. And so they were seeing the same fireworks at the same time. But the one thing about fireworks, pyrotechnics, right? Pyrotechnics, is it called pyrotechnics? Am I pronouncing that right? Some of y'all don't even know. Y'all shaking your head. Fireworks is that fireworks are designed to be theatric and dramatic. They are designed to give you a feel of brightness visually. It touches your visual perception, and then it touches your audible perception. It's what you see and what you hear. I like fireworks. I like the grand finales. How many of y'all like grand finales? Everything is going off right and left. And I tell you a story. My son, y'all remember my son Nehemiah? Naomi wasn't born yet, and Nehemiah was young, and I took him to the first fireworks experience that he ever had. We laid out. I said, I'm going to get real close, because I want my little son, Nehemiah, to experience fireworks for the first time. And he was about 7 years old, about 5 years old, a little younger. And so we got real close, laid down the blanket, and when they shot off the fireworks, we could lay down and just look at them straight up in the sky. Well, we was going good. Nehemiah was running around, having a good old time, getting cotton candy, visiting with the other families. And then the fireworks started. Huh? And then as soon as the fireworks started, he stopped. And he looked up in the sky, and he just didn't say nothing, but all of a sudden, he just started moaning. All right. And the next thing I know, the boy started all out. He was good until he felt that we were so close you could feel the remnants of the fireworks coming down. All right, he grabbed his head and started running around in circles, crying. Ronald, when the day of Pentecost fully came, they were all in one accord in one place. Now here it is. Pentecost comes from the Greek. It's a transliteration of the Greek word Pentecatas. And Pentecatas means 50. And here it says the day of Pentecost, that it is actually 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's 50 days after the resurrection that they now find themselves in the season of Pentecost. Now, Pentecost was a festival, if you will, for the people of Judaism. It was a harvest festival. It was a time where the people would celebrate the great abundance of life that God had given through the harvest. And during Pentecost, no matter if you were of the Jewish faith, you would, wherever you lived in Asia Minor, you would make your way to Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Weeks, it was called. If you want to do some historical research, go to the book of Leviticus, because Leviticus teaches us about Pentecost. Pentecost and Levitical practices, they would have to count 7 weeks from the Passover, and then on the seventh week, the 50th day of the seventh, in the seventh week, they were to celebrate what God had done for the people of Judaism. That God had provided in times past, that everything they had was a gift from God's hand, and that they were to draw together as people of Judaism and celebrate the great festival of weeks. It's called the Shavuot, if you will, in the Hebrew. But now hear me. What they were doing there was to celebrate a feast, recognizing what God has done in their history. But God shows up through the Holy Spirit and now ushers the people who have come for a feast into the realization that God has come into their midst. Pentecost for them was a time of celebration for the harvest of God, but yet on that same day, God sends the Holy Spirit to give the people a new revelation about the purpose and design of God for the people of Judaism and Christianity. So now, picture if you will, they're all there because they came to celebrate what God had done. But then God shows up and he does something they never experienced in their lives. So there they are. They're gathered there. They're about to have the meals for the celebration. They're about to give God thanks for the harvest, the plentiful harvest for the people. And God shows up in the Holy Spirit. And what they came to do was reinvented to what God wanted them to do from that point on. They came to celebrate God, but God now anoints them so they may celebrate God through Jesus Christ in the world in which they live. So listen, God shows up, that's the when, the where, they're there, they're celebrating, but then the question is, why did it happen? That's verse number 4. Go to verse number 4. Verse number 4. I'm going to give you this teaching part, and then I'm going to say something. Amen. Verse number 4. All right, let's read verse number 4 together. Why did it happen? Okay, let's read verse number 4 together.
And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance.
All right, now the New King James Version says, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other languages as the Spirit gave them the ability to speak. In other words, what happened on the day of Pentecost is that Jesus no longer filled the people, a faith, Judaism, but Jesus begins to fill people. The indwelling, somebody say the indwelling. Here is the ushering in of the indwelling. And the purpose of why the indwelling came is because Jesus needed to use humanity to share the gospel of the great commandment through the world that now exists. In other words, no longer was the message going to be reserved for the people of Judaism and those in Jerusalem, but the gospel of Jesus Christ was going to be evident in all those who believe. And Jesus needed the people to be his mouth, to be his hands, to be his feet, to take the gospel to places it had not been as of yet. Remember, come on now, remember, the people came from around the region. They came from the uttermost First Corinthians chapter number 12 and verse number 3. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12 and verse number 3. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, the next one. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12 and verse number 3. Did I say verse number 3?
Yeah.
Okay, let's read verse number 3.
Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God called Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Now listen, the first point is this. The Holy Spirit helps us to confess Christ. Write that down. The Holy Spirit helps us to confess Christ. Do you know why He sends the Holy Spirit into our lives? That if you believe and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, then you have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Y'all understand that, right? If you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. My brothers and sisters, that means the same Spirit that fell on the apostles in the first century in the day of Pentecost is the same Spirit you got inside of you. Look at the person next to you. That ain't lotion. That's the continence of God. That's the Holy Spirit. When you see folks doing right, doing good, being happy, living large with the things of God, that ain't nothing but the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit indwells you. Amen. Come on, turn to somebody and say, He indwells you. Now, come on now. Sometimes you may not recognize it, but He's always in you if you keep your heart open to Him. And see, you need to understand, the Holy Spirit is not a denominational thing. The Pentecostal church, I love them dearly. The Church of God Christ, love them dearly. Charismatic, newborn, new age faith, love them dearly. But they ain't got a premium on the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is not confined to a church, but He's inside God's people. And the first thing the Holy Spirit helps you to do, y'all got to write this down, He helps you confess Christ. He helps you to confess Christ. Now, why do you need help to confess Christ? It's because most of us, are spiritual weaklings. Say amen. We are spiritual wimps. Say amen. We don't want to talk about Jesus other than in the church. Come on, say amen. And sometimes it's hard for us. It's hard for us. Now, come on, let's be real. When we're young in the faith, new in the faith, anybody, when you were new in the faith, you were a little wishy-washy, you know, you weren't as confident. Come on now, to talk about the love of Jesus in your life, because you didn't want people to brand you as a holy roller. Y'all, they still say that? A holy roller? They were one of those holy rollers, you didn't want people to brand you, but do you know what the Holy Ghost does? The Holy Ghost gives you the confidence to confess Christ, and you are not ashamed to tell somebody about the Jesus in your life. Because if you do it on your own, you would say, well, you know, I can't say that because, you know, they don't want me to talk about Jesus in the workplace. That's a plan of the devil to keep you from saying nothing, saying anything about the goodness of the Lord. But understand, when you are bold in your confession of faith, you don't give a hoot what anybody says about you. You don't care what people think about you. You're just standing on the truth that the same God that lifted me and began your life to can lift you too. It's a confidence. And do you know why? Come on now. Do you know why Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to them? It's so that they can be used of God to tell somebody that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. It's about being bold. I hear some folks, it just gets on my last sanctified nerve. What little nerve I got. I can go places and hear people talk junk about sporting events. I can hear them talk junk about whether they hit the lotto or didn't hit the lotto. I can hear them talk smack about whether it's up to $238 million. I got to hurry up, get to the store. You coming with me? You want to break off a piece? I can hear them talk stuff about the things that really don't matter. But when it comes to the most said Jeter, right? And because it was an ecumenical function, right? And he came back from the ecumenical function, and I said, did you pray the prayer? And he said, how did you pray? He said, I prayed in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. I said, that's my boy Jeter right there. Huh? Just because they tell you that you can't, don't mean you shouldn't. Huh? When it comes to your faith, huh? I like school teachers. Sister Washington used to be a school teacher. You know, I used to be a school teacher. I did. All right, I'm going to get to my other point in a minute. I used to be... You imagining me in front of your kids too, yeah, I have trouble with that as well. But I used to be a school teacher, and they said, you know, they knew that I had given my life to the Lord and was, you know, didn't compromise. So they said, you know, you can't pray with the kids. All right, we can't have any demonstration of public prayer. That's why we got so much mess in our schools anyway. But you can't have public prayer. Well, you know, my faith was really tested one day. Let's call him Little Johnny. Little Johnny lost his mind. Little Johnny's mama was coming in, who had lost her mind as well. And I had to be me. Huh? So Little Johnny had rubbed me the wrong way on several occasions. In this last occasion, he rubbed me the wrong way. So Little Johnny's mama was coming, and everybody was afraid of Little Johnny's mama. So Little Johnny, you know I'm not teaching no more. You all know that, right? Little Johnny, so I had enough of Little Johnny. I grabbed Little Johnny by the back of the neck. And for the first time in my life, I had a healing ministry. Because I laid my hand on the top of his head. I said, in the name of Jesus, get thee behind me, Satan. Because, Lord, if you don't hold me right now, I'm going to lay Little Johnny out, and then his mama going to come and give her a piece too. So in the name of Jesus. Little Johnny, I don't know what happened to the boy, but he looked up at me. He said, I think he saw something in my eye or something. Because Little Johnny just... Mr. Porter was right. Mama, you need to go home. Little Johnny was in a trance. He was in a trance. The next year I stopped teaching. Say amen. Little Johnny and I, and Little Johnny calls me every now and then. Yeah. So, hey, that was my point. You gotta confess Christ. Turn to somebody and say, just confess Christ. The next point, go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12 and verse number 12. Let's look at verse number 12. All right, verse number 12. Let's read, you get it? All right, let's read verses 12 and 13. Let's read those.